following is a presentation of HBO Sports.
For decades, Madison Square Garden stood alone as the venue for boxing's best. Jack Dempsey, Ray Robinson, Rocky Marciano, Muhammad Ali versus Joe Frazier in the true fight of the century. In recent years, it's been the Garden's 5,500-seat theater which has hosted some of the sport's rising stars, an intimate space in which to build their careers and showcase their elite talents on Broadway. Arturo Gatti made his name here. Roy Jones amazed here. Gennady Golovkin dazzled here.
There it is, Pasak Thunder.
Countless fighters have graced this venue, honored their sport, and polished their craft. Tonight, fast-rising action hero Nicholas Walters makes his theater debut. Walters is fresh off highlight reel knockout wins over Victor Chinian and Nonuto Donaire.
Walters with two more right hands, and Donaire is down again.
And will add his name to this building's history against undefeated Colombian knockout artist Miguel Mariaga. But before our main event, our first look at Uber prospect Felix Verdejo. Verdejo stands alone as the heir apparent to the Puerto Rican boxing throne and continues his own historic journey against fellow undefeated up-and-comer Ivan Najera. Boxing After Dark is next.
Boxing After Dark is back, coming to you with doubleheader action from the theater in Madison Square Garden. Our main event features Nicholas Walters, a fast-rising star from Jamaica, riding high off of back-to-back demolitions of Victor Chinian and Nonuto Donaire. Walters will take on little-known Colombian knockout artist Miguel Mariaga, and we have some very good little-known fighters have emerged from Colombia over the years. But before our main event, HBO's first look at star Puerto Rican prospect Felix Verdejo, who is universally recognized as one of the very best young talents in the sport. And he will be matching up with another undefeated prospect in Ivan Najera. In fact, all four fighters on the card tonight are unbeaten coming in. Hello again, everybody. I'm Jim Lampley. We welcome you to this special doubleheader at the theater at Madison Square Garden. In the main event, Nicholas Walters will try to continue his unbeaten record, but if you follow the sport on the web, you may know that the main event fight has already been significantly affected by what happened at the weigh-in yesterday when Walters could not make the 126-pound featherweight limit, had to give up his title on the scale. He will enter the fight tonight having weighed in 1 pound over the limit, and we'll discuss the implications of that later on when we get to the main event. But first, a matchup on the undercard between Felix Verdejo and young Ivan Najera. Let's turn our attention back to the main event as we turn to our expert commentator, Roy Jones, at ringside. Roy, when we get to the fight between Walters and Mariaga, we're talking about a situation where 7 years ago, in an Olympic qualifier, Mariaga beat Nicholas Walters. Walters says he has only vague memories of the amateur loss. You're the king of understanding how to be motivated through your pro career by something bad that happened in the amateurs. How vague do you suppose those memories are?
Well, it's so vague, Jim, that he wants to come back and erase the memory. If it was so vague, he wouldn't be interested in coming here and redefining the fight now, making a new end to it. So we guys in boxing sometimes have selective memory. We don't remember the things that didn't quite go our way as amateurs, Antonio Tarver, and we forget about everything that happened, we say. But when the end comes, he's fighting this guy for a particular reason tonight, because he wants vindication.
All right, but first, before we get to Walters, as we said, it's young Felix Verdejo in his first exposure here, fighting against Ivan Najera. You see the spectacular smile for Verdejo. What kind of Puerto Rican fighter will he be? Can he be the kind of two-way offensive and defensive force that Wilfred Benitez was? Can he be the kind of stand-up power puncher that Felix Trinidad was? Can he be the kind of punishing body puncher that Miguel Cotto was and still is? Or can he be a combination of all three of those kinds of things? We turn to HBO boxing analyst Max Kellerman. Max, how high is the upside for Felix Verdejo?
Sky's the limit, both as a ticket seller. He has an ethnic fan base, obviously, that's very into boxing because the Puerto Rican fight fans love him already. And as an actual fighter, I asked Vasily Lomachenko, who beat Verdejo in the Olympics, because Lomachenko beat everyone in the Olympics and in the amateurs. Lomachenko's maybe the greatest amateur fighter ever. He's on a short list anyway. And I said, what do you think of Verdejo? And I know you beat him. And Lomachenko said, that was nothing. He was a baby. He is going to be a great fighter.
Well, we'll see how great he looks tonight in this event against the unbeaten Nahera, who has a high degree of motivation going against Verdejo. Fight takes place in the lightweight division, limit 135. Let's take a look at the tail of the tape. For Felix Verdejo against San Antonio, Texas, Nivan Nahera. And you see that they are both 22 years old. There's a 3-inch height advantage for Verdejo and a 1.5-inch arm length advantage. Measured from the armpit to the end of the fist, they both weighed in well under the 135-pound limit. Verdejo at 133 and Nahera at 131.5. And you can see that Nahera has rehydrated 15.5 pounds overnight, unofficially up to 147 on our scale, whereas Verdejo is a little bit more moderate in that regard, only 11 pounds of rehydration to 144. Here comes Ivan Nahera to his biggest win. It was several weeks ago. He started his career 9-0 with 9 straight knockouts. Since that time, 7 wins all by decision. He says that his favorite punch is the left hook to the body. And interestingly, although he is of Mexican heritage and lives in Mexican-American community of San Antonio, Texas, he says that his favorite fighter is Miguel Cotto. So the world is becoming very democratic, Max.
That's right, especially since Verdejo's favorite fighter is Juan Manuel Marquez. The Mexican-American fighter loves the Puerto Rican, and the Puerto Rican fighter idolizes the Mexican-American. We have a good fighter here, a good young fighter who believes in himself and is showing up to upset the apple cart.
So Nahera in the ring says he has confidence in himself and doesn't care about all the adulation for Verdejo. 2012 Puerto Rican Olympian Felix Verdejo has long been considered the heir apparent to the island boxing throne occupied for so many years by Miguel Cotto and before him Felix Trinidad. Part of fulfilling that promise is building a fan base here in New York where he's fighting for the 5th time as a pro and feeling right at home.
When I went to the cultural center in the Bronx, when I got out of the van, the people would come to me and they would ask me for autographs and take pictures. You know, I could barely walk, but their support was something very special for me, and I take it with me in my heart. And all the people would tell me to keep working hard, and to never change my personality, never change who I was, and never change and never lose that smile on my face. I'm very proud to be Puerto Rican. The fighter that I most admired in Puerto Rico was the people's champion, was Felix Tito Trinidad. And that's who inspired me to become a fighter. For me, it fills me with pride, it fills me with honor to be one of the next fighters that the island recognizes as its own, as a talent. And they compare me with Felix Tito Trinidad, Miguel Angel Cotto, Wilfredo Gomez also. They were great fighters. You know, that motivates me, that they compare me with people that gave glory to my country. You know, they made their history, and I need to make mine.
Now, here comes Verdejo. Tomorrow morning, Verdejo will be boarding a float to ride in the annual Puerto Rican Day Parade here in New York. That particular quinella, fighting here in the Garden and then riding in the Puerto Rican Day Parade, has in the past been the province of Miguel Cotto. And for Verdejo to get to do that, Roy Jones, is a terrific honor for a fighter so early in his career.
Yes, a terrific honor for a fighter who's well deserving of it, because if we take all of those great Puerto Rican stars that we had from the past and put them together, he is showing us a promise of that complete Puerto Rican champion.
Yeah, maybe more Wilfredo Gomez than any of the guys we've mentioned so far. He has an accessible, fan-friendly personality and such high upside that he will, the hope is, grow the ethnic following to just a boxing following. The way Gennady Golovkin is loved by boxing fans even with a lack of an ethnic following, because he's so good and brings so much excitement and has such a fan-friendly personality.
Felix Verdejo and Ivan Nahera are in the ring. Let's go to Michael Buffer for the official introductions.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening and welcome to the theater here in Madison Square Garden, New York City, New York, USA, where tonight Bob Arum's Top Rank Incorporated is proud to present an evening of world-class professional boxing for your entertainment. It's all undefeated fighters versus undefeated fighters live on HBO. All contests are sanctioned by the New York State Athletic Commission. Now, before we continue, on behalf of the aforementioned promoter, Mr. Bob Arum, along with HBO Sports and Madison Square Garden, our congratulations to the class of 2015 being inducted into the International Boxing Hall of Fame. And ladies and gentlemen, tonight here at ringside, we have one of those men about to be enshrined officially tomorrow. A round of applause for the new member of the Boxing Hall of Fame, HBO's own Gentleman Jim Lampley. And now, ladies and gentlemen, the three judges assigned for this next contest, Matt Ruggiero, Don Trella, and Steve Weisfeld, your referee in charge of the action at the bell, Ricky Gonzalez. And now on the line, the WBO Latino title, 10 rounds of boxing. This is in the lightweight division. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing black with the Mexican flag trim, weighing in officially at 131, 1.5 pounds. His professional record, a perfect one. 16 fights, 16 victories, including 8 wins by knockout from San Antonio, Texas, USA. He is the challenger, undefeated El Invicto, Ivan Nahera. And his opponent across the ring, fighting out of the red corner, wearing gray and red, and officially weighing in at 133 pounds. Also, a perfect professional record consisting of 17 fights, 17 victories, including 13 wins by knockout, de San Juan, Puerto Rico, El Invicto, WBO Latino Lightweight Champion, Felix Verdejo.
Gave you your instructions in the dressing room. I expect a good, clean fight. Protect yourself at all times. Obey my commands at all times. Ya te di las reglas en el camerino. Protégese todo el tiempo. Y siempre obedece mis órdenes. Touch glove, toca el guante.
Felix Verdejo's debut on HBO. The idea here is you get to see a superstar before he was a superstar. But in order to do that, he has to shine against a tough, young, undefeated fighter in Nahera, who sees himself as the future star.
We don't want to get too far ahead of ourselves as we watch Verdejo getting started here against Ivan Nahera, but looking at that body, Roy Jones, looking at his height, looking at his shoulders, I'm thinking that 135 is just the beginning. Certainly we'll see him at welterweight someday and maybe even above, right?
Yeah, maybe even junior middleweight, even middleweight. This guy has a perfect stance, perfect height, perfect formation to become a much bigger and much more effective fighter. And much like Tito Trinidad, I think he can carry his punch up to the higher weight classes with him because of his power, because of his height.
And you mentioned maybe he's a combination of many Puerto Rican standouts in the past in terms of style, Roy. He can fight on his toes. He can fight aggressively. He can play some defense. He has fast hands, fast feet, punching power.
Very high caliber type of a fighter, Max. He can do a lot of things. He has all the physical attributes, all the boxing attributes that makes for great superstars in this sport.
Nahera, in his last fight against Robbie Cannon all the way back in February, acknowledged to us yesterday that he was a little sluggish after putting on a lot of weight overnight. Once again here, he has put on a large amount of weight overnight. So we'll see if he's able to keep up with the pace that will be set by young Verdejo.
Well, it was not a bad idea tonight, Jim, because Verdejo is such a much bigger specimen height-wise that you will need the extra weight to be able to deal with his punching power. Verdejo has power in both hands, very quick, and has an extraordinary jab.
Just snaked a nice left hook behind Harris' guard.
The good thing you like about Nahara is that he knows what he's up against. He's not expecting to come out and outbox Verdejo early, but he knows that he's the guy who has to come push the issue and try to make it a deep fight, a deep water fight, like going to the eighth and ninth round.
See what Verdejo's able to do as Nahara's putting on pressure. He landed three quick little punches on the inside. He shortened the distance of the punches. Right in the middle of the ring, an opponent with his guard up, and he was still able to connect.
Fight is scheduled for 10 rounds. Verdejo has been able to land his jab and quick left hook here in the first round. Nahara, who says his favorite punch and best punch is left hook to the body, goes right along with his designation of Miguel Cotto as his favorite fighter, hasn't gotten that shot in quite yet.
And it's pretty hard for him to get it in right away because he has to keep his left hand at home to deal with Verdejo's right hand.
Nahara very conscious of Verdejo's reported punching power, staying in the peekaboo guard for much of the round as Felix Verdejo moves and boxes and seems fairly easily to win the round.
You can't block those. Look at the water. You can't be passive on the defense. Breathe deeply. How you feel? Good? Good. All right. Let's work that jab. Work that jab to the chest. You're throwing it up top. You got to throw it to the chest. Jab the chest and jab the body. Breathe. Again.
Relax.
That's it. Relax. Do your job. Jab, jab, jab. Work the sides.
Combi box numbers in round one. Verdejo fighting at a measured pace, able to pick his spots where he wanted to be throwing punches, where he wanted not to do so, landing 9 out of 37. Nahara, 6 landed punches, throwing only 29 in the round.
Roy, you heard in Verdejo's corner, his corner didn't want him to be passive on defense. What do you think they meant by that?
Well, they don't want him to just stand there when Verdejo comes in at him, Nahara, comes in at him, because if he lets Nahara get started, he may get hit first. You always want your guy to be first on defense or offense so that he doesn't get caught with a shot just sitting there.
And Nahara has decided to get busy here in round two. Sudden burst of activity as he charged Verdejo and fired a fusillade of body shots, and Verdejo weathers the storm easily and now puts Nahara in jeopardy along the ropes. Nahara drops his hands as if to say, I don't think you've got all that much, and Verdejo sizes him up again. Hard right hand, quick left hook. Both landed solidly for Verdejo. Jab knocks Nahara back into the ropes. Verdejo is the first to go to the left hook to the body. And now, Nahara tries it himself.
Nahara's not showing up to lose tonight.
Now, he's a very game fighter, and these are the type of fights that you want to see Verdejo in, because it forces him to keep his cool and still operate in a pressurous situation.
There was a good right hand up the middle moments ago.
Well, I see what you mean, Roy Jones, when you say that Verdejo has an extraordinary jab. It's a snake which seems to extend as he throws it.
It keeps a lot of guys out of reach or out of range to hit him when he throws it. So you have to step inside of that range which makes you subjective to the other punches, like that hook right there that he throws.
He's very quick with the check hook.
Yeah, very quick with it.
You can't go back against a tall, rangy guy with power and a good jab, and if you come forward, he'll check you with a hook.
Verdejo reaching with the right hand to the body. Max Kellerman says fighters don't throw the right hand to the body enough.
Take a risk when you go to Verdejo's body because of the quick hands and the reach.
Exactly.
And the punching power.
Yeah, you have to get all the way in or don't go near it, because if you step halfway to get that body shot, he's definitely going to counter you with a left hook or a straight right hand.
I think that's exactly the reason why Nahera did not try to counter Verdejo's right-hand body shot with his left hook, because Verdejo threw it from a position where he couldn't get at it. June 23, or June 27, I should say, Tim Bradley returns to world championship boxing against undefeated Jesse Vargas. Vargas is the current 140-pound title holder and is stepping up in weight for this one. July 25, Sergey Kovalev, fresh off his knockout win over Jean Pascal in one of this year's best fights, takes on Najib Mohammadi. Also that night, the aforementioned Pascal matches up with Yuneski Gonzalez. Let me be technically accurate. We say here that Vargas is stepping up in weight for his matchup with Tim Bradley. He spent the first part of his career at welterweight, then moved down to 140 to be stronger at that weight, and now is going back up to 147. Roy Jones, you trained him. Is he capable of fighting at 147?
Yeah, he's capable of it, Jim. Here you see Verdejo land a good straight right hand high on the head, followed by a good left hook high on the head. Both punches high on the head, but shots that if they were a little lower on the chin could have been much more effective.
Very interesting CompuBox number here. In the first round, all his punches counted. Verdejo landed 9 of 37. In the second round, he threw 37 jabs and landed 9.
Very smart guy, very smart move, because the jab is the best punch for him right now. When you're fighting a shorter opponent, stick that jab out there, force him to deal with that, make him take chances and have to gamble behind your jab. And Jim, you were asking me about Vargas. Vargas can do a really good job at 147. However, Tim Bradley is a tough test at any weight class.
Thank you. Seems that whenever Nahera sets up to try to make an offensive move, Verdejo just sticks the left hand out and hits him with the jab or the check hook.
And that's what I said. You know, he uses his range very wisely. He doesn't have to be the aggressive. He can use that jab and make Nahera have to come in and take chances behind his jab.
He's a classic Verdejo boxer puncher. You see him backing up to get the right range on his punches, coming forward when he needs to, when he senses a vulnerability.
Taking his time. Very calculative on his attack. You gotta love seeing a fighter like Verdejo.
Verdejo landed a good sharp right hand lead seconds ago, and Nahera dropped both hands at that time. Was he asking Verdejo to keep throwing so he could counter?
No, he's basically just trying to let Verdejo know that he's not bothered by the power that you're hitting him with. He's still gonna be in the fight. He doesn't mind getting hit. He'll take one to land one. So that's the type of fighter that this kid, Ivan Nahera, is. Nahera.
That's it. There's the right hand lead again. And the quick hook.
That's the one he has to avoid, that straight right lead right there, Jim. If that lands on the chin, that could lead to some real problems.
A lot of times, fighters in this phase of Verdejo's career, 17 fights, will say, I'm ready for anyone, I'm at the top. Verdejo doesn't feel that way. He feels he's still developing and heading toward the top. But you could see from the talent already, he would give anybody problems.
Of course, and he knows that. Max is just, he's smart, he's taking his time. He's just like he is out here in the boxing ring. He's very calculative with his attack, and I'm sure he'll be the same way in choosing opponents and choosing the time to attack the right opponent.
Yeah, good timing, as you're seeing so far tonight, in and out of the ring.
Right hand knocks Nahera back. Verdejo getting more and more confident with his right hand, setting it up in a variety of ways. Still to come tonight, Nicholas Walters, who had a featherweight title but gave it up on the scale yesterday, will be taking on Miguel Mariaga, another unbeaten fighter from Colombia. Colombia, noteworthy over the years for turning out punchers. Mariaga has 18 knockouts and 20 fights coming in. His victory over Walters 7 years ago in the amateurs was a decision.
Throw your jab.
Muévete.
Touch the jab. All right. Water.
Igual. Las cuerdas no te quiero así.
I don't want you on the ropes. I don't want you on the ropes because you can catch.
No, agáchese. Viene con
nosotros. Throw and go down.
Buen trabajo. Tranquilito. Llévatela.
You saw that Iván Najera is trained by his father, Marco, and his father has trained him ever since childhood. He was asking his son to throw the jab more, be more assertive in trying to set up his own offense against Félix Verdejo. 20 seconds into round number four. Harold, how have you scored the first three?
Okay, Jim, not a hard fight to score. 3-0, 30-27. Félix Verdejo. You know, Jim, for two rounds, Félix Verdejo circled, landed a lot of good left jabs, that hard right hand once in a while. But in round three, he started to set his feet, step forward, and throw that knockout right hand he's got. You know, that brutal right hand. He didn't do that the first two rounds, as I saw it. He circled like he is now. But in round three, he really stepped it up and looked for the KO. 3-0, Félix Verdejo.
Good body shots by Najera.
He also landed a good left hook, Jim.
Yes, he did.
But it did not faze Verdejo at all.
Well, that's one thing we'll learn about Verdejo as he goes along. How good is the chin? Whether the left hook from Najera comes back with offense of his own. Good hard right hand by Verdejo.
Oh, that rally by Najera really got Verdejo mad.
Absolutely.
Woke him up, and these right uppercuts that he's landing are some vicious uppercuts, Jim.
But that's something he's going to have to learn to control. His emotions, his temper. Maybe not against an outgunned opponent, but there will come a time.
You know, when you look at that smile, you wouldn't think he was capable of that kind of angry response. Great left hook to the body.
Did that hurt?
By Félix Verdejo, and he's wobbled Najera now, and he's all over him on the ropes.
Yeah, Najera was hurt bad by that body shot.
Long time left in the round. Najera doing a good job now of weathering the storm after getting hurt badly to the body by Félix Verdejo.
And good uppercut by Najera. Has the heart of gold, Najera does.
And that's probably Najera's best chance when Verdejo throws caution to the wind and just looks for his own offense. Najera's best chance to actually win the fight may be to exchange. Yes, he would likely be knocked out, but at least it gives him a chance to unload something big.
Najera has grit. He seems to have a fairly full offensive package. Just doesn't have the superstar quickness that Félix Verdejo has.
Usually what separates the elite fighters from the good fighters.
Another long, hard right hand by Verdejo. Good left hook again inside by Iván Najera. And he backs Verdejo up. And Verdejo fires back with the right hand again. What a fight. We've got a war going on in round number four.
Boy, Verdejo has that championship thing in him, doesn't he?
Both of them does.
He doesn't.
Both
he
of them
want,
do.
You hit him, he's hitting you back and
yes,
harder.
Sir.
What a round four.
Get down the wall. Crouch and walk in.
Hey, those combinations work for you. Work them.
You're at his range,
don't
dude.
Don't
that's good. That's good.
Just do your thing and move. Okay? You're doing good, man. You're doing real good. Just your head.
Keep your guard up.
He's here, Verdejo land overhand right, but they got around behind the glove, followed by a left hook that was on the neck. But then you see, as Najera is punching back, boom, there's a good overhand right on the chin that pushed Iván Najera backwards.
Power shots in round number four. Verdejo 20 out of 38. Najera 18 out of 40. Together they landed 44 punches in a terrific round. And go to the fifth.
That's the type of round that Nogueira needs. He needs to be exchanging, like Max said earlier, if he's going to win this fight. He's not going to outbox Felix Verdejo. He has to try to outbang him. That's his only chance.
He has to take risks.
Exactly. That's what he did in the latter part of that last
especially
round.
Especially since you see that championship impulse in Verdejo, that fighting spirit is to hit his opponent back harder and last when they're in exchanges. Verdejo does, Roy, to me, have seemed so far in this fight to have a slight tendency to muscle some of those shots instead of just letting them flow when he's looking to put some mustard on.
Well, he does, Max, but you know there comes a time in a fight sometime that you have to make a stance and let a guy know that I don't care how it feels or how it looks, you're not just going to run in here on me. Good body shot.
Oh. That hurt bad. Left body bothered Nogueira. Once again, he backs away. Verdejo sizes him up along the ropes again. Nogueira able to duck and slip.
Now let's see if Verdejo recognizes to go back to the body.
Of course he recognizes. He went at it right away. He knows.
Because that was one of those beginning of the end type left hooks to the body.
There was a right hand to the body right afterwards to follow up on that attack.
First minute of this round was pretty civilized compared to the action in round number four, but then Verdejo landed that left hook to the body. Now Nogueira has to try to answer back.
Uppercut to be exact.
That really was an uppercut, wasn't it? Yeah. Six,
seven,
the hooker cut.
Eight. You want to continue? Step to me, step to me, step to me.
It's finish time. See if Verdejo can do it.
He's trying, I tell you that. Got a tough cookie he's trying to get, but he's definitely trying.
Throwing shots back and all that trouble on the ropes.
Nogueira has guts for days.
Hey, San Antonio has nothing to be worried about here, sir. Their fighter is giving it his all.
And usually in a fight like this, the B-side realizes at a certain point, I can't win. And even though they're game, they stop trying to win. That is not the case here. This
not
is the fighter, Nogueira, who still believes he can win. You can see the way he's fighting.
He's undefeated, and he wants to keep his oath.
That's a great point, Roy. Do you think Nogueira might not be reacting this way if he had previously lost a fight?
Well, he wouldn't be reacting this way had he previously lost, but since he hasn't, he wants to keep it that way.
Uh-huh. It's all right, no problem. You good?
Right.
Nothing's wrong. Give me water.
You were about to start exchanging with them. Don't do that.
Here, Jim, when you see a guy block the 1-2 hook, you throw a 1-2 and follow with a left uppercut. He never saw it coming. Had the hand up for the hook, he would have blocked the hook, but he could not block the uppercut.
Great point.
And it surprised him. Boom, right down the middle. As you see, the right glove was in perfect position to block a hook.
Well called, Roy Jones. It was a perfect vertical uppercut, not the hook as I called it during the round. And for the reason that Roy described, to get it around the right glove that Nogueira was trying to use to block the hook.
So far, you can see why Nogueira was selected as an opponent. He's game, he's tough, he has some skills. He can test Verdejo in certain respects a little, but ultimately hasn't scored a knockout, as you mentioned, off the top, Jim, in a long time. 7 consecutive fights without a knockout, and so doesn't have the pop to put Verdejo in trouble when he does land.
Yeah, but when you step up in competition, man, which also could be the problem, sometimes those knockouts stop happening. So I wouldn't say he doesn't have the power to put Verdejo in trouble, but Verdejo has shown the ability to absorb a really good shot here.
Well, we made the point at the top of the telecast that since Nogueira has stepped up gradually in competition, the knockouts have disappeared, and he's had seven consecutive decision wins to preserve his unbeaten record coming in.
Well, you can see it. He's not feather-fisted, but he's not a devastating puncher. He's a solid puncher. Not someone, if you're matching Verdejo at this stage in his career, that you have to worry about catching your prospect with one big shot that would take him out.
Verdejo's promoter, Top Rank, is often given credit for being the best at gradually stepping up a prospect's competition along the way and nurturing him in such a way that he maximizes his talent. Obviously, that's what they're trying to get done with Felix Verdejo.
And they did a pretty good job of it here because this guy is just tough enough to make Verdejo go deep into the bag of tricks, and Verdejo is doing a great job of going deep into that bag.
Doesn't mean they never make a mistake. You always have some risk involved in the equation, but generally speaking, they've done extremely well at bringing prospects along.
Anyone who gets hit on the chin can go, even if it's not a devastating puncher.
That's Verdejo exactly just right. Got hit on the chin by a right-hand lead.
And with a guy with a heart as big as Ivan Nahera is, it's very difficult to say he's not going to be dangerous anyway. He has a heart of stone.
Yeah, very few fighters are still looking to win after the punishment he absorbed in the last several rounds. And here he is forcing the fight.
Still trying to win it.
Yeah.
Nahera outlanding Verdejo in this round. Verdejo threw a lot of punches in the last minute of the fifth round, maybe coasting just a little bit here in the sixth to preserve his energy.
A very smart thing. Something else that's very professional by Verdejo.
Tuesday, June 23, it's the premiere of the next installment of Real Sports, where in light of the recent FIFA scandal, we revisit our story on the controversial 2022 Qatar World Cup and take a look at some startling new issues which have emerged.
Get on.
It's time to. But I want you to throw. I want you to throw. Pressure. Pressure. No more just combination three punches. Throw. And then get down and tighten up on the defense. Tighten up on the defense so the uppercut can't get in. Work the body or work the left. Jab, jab, wait for the uppercut on the right hand. He's going to eat that one. All of it on the inside. You catch his hand, over the top. All right, on the inside.
Igual, así no quiero este round. Ya después vamos a discutirnos. ¿Eh, güey?
Pretty good offensive fight as we go to round seven. Both fighters, by CompuBox count, landing more than 40% of their punches. That's a lot of contact in a fight like this.
A whole lot of contact.
Harold, how do you have it through six?
Okay, Jim, I got it 6-0, 60-53, Felix Verdejo. You know, Jim, that round six, if you wanted to find a round to give to Ivan Nahera, that might have been it, but I still think Felix Verdejo outboxed him. In round five, Felix gets an extra point. It's a 10-8 round for that gorgeous left hook, left uppercut that trapped Ivan Nahera. Give Felix an extra point for that. So all in all, I have it a shutout, 60-53. Felix Verdejo.
Now there's a right uppercut by Verdejo. And earlier while Harold was speaking, you saw him throw the left uppercut again. But he took a little bit of a risk, Roy Jones, throwing it from distance. Still, he's sticking with the uppercut because he knows it's got a good shot of landing the way Nahera defends.
Yeah, it has a great shot of landing. And that's
another
one. That's what he put him down with, was the left. So why not try the right, which conventionally should be more powerful than the left?
You can see through this fight so far, Verdejo does a lot of things really well, and asking about which former Puerto Rican star he's most reminiscent of. Trinidad, if he hit a guy this many times, the guy's not still standing. It's not Trinidad. Good snappy power, but not Trinidad power. But he has a little more bounce in his legs and better movement than Trinidad. And he's you can see he has a complete arsenal, especially for a fighter who's considered to be still in the developmental stages of his career. He's already mostly complete, you know, on his way to being complete.
So do you, oh, good left hook by Nahera. And let's see if we see that fire back mentality from Verdejo again.
Already saw it, Jimmy. Fire back with a good overhand right to come on Nahara down right away.
So, Max, are you going to go with your Wilfredo Gomez comparison
that's
there?
That's very, very high praise and way too early, but a well, I'm trying to say a well-rounded fighter.
Anything is high praise when we're talking about the kinds of fighters that Puerto Rico has turned out at the superstar level.
Yep.
Uppercut again, this time to the body by Felix Verdejo.
And let me just say this. We're not talking about pound-for-pound power because I think Wilfredo Gomez was one of the best pound-for-pound punches in both hands ever.
Exactly.
Down goes Nahara again.
That's pretty good power right there.
That was a tremendous shot.
And what I was going to say was, even with Felix Trinidad, we didn't see him drop as many people with his left hand as we're seeing this kid drop tonight. Mm-hmm. So.
That's a great point, Roy. Trinidad was a classic right-hand puncher.
That's right. This guy has power in both hands.
Keep your damn hands up. He can't touch you. Two times he caught you with your hands down. Your guard. Dude, you have him, dude. Keep your guard up. After you throw your combinations, keep it up. Breathe. Breathe with me. Let's go.
This is eight.
Now you've got a pressure and throw.
This time, Jimmy Sim used the check hook after the straight right hand, blocks it, and throws a beautiful check hook as Nareha was trying to throw a jab, jump right into that left hook, which is right where you don't want to be when you fight a guy taller than you.
That's an arm punch, Roy. Yeah. He doesn't even have his body momentum into that punch.
No, he doesn't, but he turned just enough to have enough power into it to drop him.
Yeah. Verdejo's able to get torque on those shots, even when maybe he's not supposed to be able to get torque on them.
So Felix Verdejo well ahead on Harold Lederman's unofficial scorecard as we come to the eighth round of a scheduled 10. Increasingly, the question becomes an academic one. Is he going to be able to knock Nahara out? Most likely, his promoter would say, well, if he goes the full 10, good education, great experience, he dominated the opponent, that's what we wanted to see.
And I would say the same thing, Jim. You want to see him go the distance, carry his power to the late rounds like he's doing here, and remain disciplined enough to do just what he needs to do to win the fight and to keep it exciting.
I'm sure they wouldn't be disappointed with a knockout.
He's fighting in the 135-pound weight class. Max Kellerman, he says, if I needed to, if business dictated, I could make 130. He'd be even more powerful at 130.
He just doesn't look like a junior lightweight to me. He looks more like a junior welterweight.
I agree. Just looks like too big a body for 130.
Yep.
Good jab hook.
Now, what do you mean by jab hook?
He threw a jab and turned it right into a hook immediately. Not many guys besides people like Sugar Ray Robinson, real fighters could do things like that. Good jab, pivot hook right there. So he's showing you a real arsenal, Jim. To understand boxing, Harold understands, but you don't see that kind of stuff often in up-and-coming fighters.
Right. The
hook off the jab, then pivot with the jab and throw the hook.
You're looking at a guy who's on his way to being a complete boxer puncher.
A complete superstar.
His trainer, Ricardo Marquez, does not exactly have a global profile. Generally speaking, the technical level of instruction in Puerto Rico is very strong.
Yeah, it is. It's very strong. Puerto Rico, for that small of an island, always produces some true, real talent. And this guy's another one of those guys who has that true talent, true skill for boxing.
It's unreal the kind of talent Puerto Rico produces, considering the size and population of the island.
I wonder if Ivan Nahara's father will give consideration to stopping the fight. It's becoming target practice, and Verdejo is bouncing Nahara's head around with some very big shots here in round number 8.
Well, he bounced his ribs around with a very good right hook to the body just then. That hurt far worse than all of those head shots that he caught Nahara with.
You have to love Felix's accuracy in this round.
And his patience, Jim. The body work has taken all of the power off of Ivan's punches. Ivan Nahara has not much power left in either hand right now.
Exactly right.
So from a competitive standpoint, it would appear that the fight is over. The question is, does Ivan Nahara's father want him to go the distance and take more punishment against Felix Verdejo?
You're good, dude. You're good, dude. I just don't want you on the ropes. I don't want you on the ropes, dude. The only way you're going to win is you got to put it down. Come on, you won for this. You trained for this. The step that you practiced so much with your father, you've got to do with it, that same movement.
Here you see Verdejo come in with a left hook followed by a beautiful overhand right, right on the button. That punch usually finishes most people, but you got to get Ivan the credit. Ivan has a heck of a chin.
Tough
and
cookie.
Then he comes right back in with that same overhand right again, right behind the glove on the chin again. And Ivan Nahara took those punches like a real champion.
I mentioned in the last round it's becoming target practice, and Verdejo's pretty good going to the target. Power punches in the last two rounds, Felix Verdejo landing 37 out of 52. That's about 70%.
Pretty dang good.
Neither fighter's ever been to the ninth round before. Verdejo looks as though he could go 15. At least against this particular opponent. And this particular opponent was impressive in the early rounds. He showed guts, determination, skill, landed some clean shots, but gradually, with his super accurate power punching, Felix Verdejo has taken over the fight and nullified Ivan Nahara.
Somewhat broken the fighter down. That's what you want to see young guys do. Come in the ring, take a guy to school, and break him down throughout the duration of a 10-round fight. Now you see him use something that he hasn't used already, which is a beautiful jab to the body. Ivan still telling him, come on. Ivan is one game character, Jim. You gotta love seeing a guy like him in a big fight like this, and you hope he only lives to get better and get another opportunity like this somewhere down the line. Because he truly deserves it.
A lot of fans here, especially Puerto Rican fans, I'm sure want to see Verdejo close the show. He's put on a really good performance. But in the last round or two, there it is, a certain kind of energy is flattened out, it feels to me, in the arena, as though people are resigned to the fact that this might go the distance and Verdejo wins by, you know, shutout and extra points for knockdowns. But a couple rounds ago, and it looked like he might score the knockout, it felt like it was building to a crescendo, and that seems to have passed to me.
Well, the difference is, Max, he's not into what we call Mexican style. He's not out here to kill. He's a very good-looking fighter who's out here to box, take advantage of what he has. If the guy comes in wrong, he'll knock the guy out. If the guy doesn't make a crazy mistake, then he's cool with the guy going the distance. He's landed enough punches. He's knocked him down enough. He's shown us everything tonight. So he doesn't have to be over-aggressive and use the Mexican style, because that's not what's going to best benefit him down the line.
Max, we are on Manhattan Island, and the main event is between a Jamaican and a Colombian. So is Felix Verdejo, in fact, the ticket seller here tonight?
Seems to me.
Did all right, didn't he?
Yes. For his debut on HBO.
Arena appears to be about 80% full.
Main support to the main event.
Head movement, dude. Keep your hands up.
Está bien.
Good.
No hay pedo.
You're good, no problem.
La forma de este güey es noquearlo.
What we have to do is knock him out, dude. That's it. But please, don't get hit this round, dude. Man hurts? Yeah, the left one? Okay. Well, let's box him then. Box him then. If your hand hurts, then work with that jab to the chest and keep moving. And the right hard right hand. All right, again.
Round 10. First time to the 10th round for both fighters.
Somebody already celebrating, Jim. It smells like they're having a party.
It smells that way.
Harold, how do you have it so far?
Okay, Jim. I got it 9-0, 90-79, Felix Verdejo. Give him an extra point in round 7 and round 5 for the knockdown. But, Jim, I got to tell you something. I'm so against a guy having his father in a corner. I mean, after Ivan Hera took a terrible beating in round 8, the father's telling him about how he trained in San Antonio and telling him not to get hit. Well, what's he supposed to do not to get hit? I mean, I didn't expect the old man was going to stop the fight. That just never happens. But some of the stuff that the father say, a level of really get these kids hurt.
You could hear why maybe I said the energy seemed to flatten out when it looked like there was some resignation that she could go the distance. Verdejo in the corner, first in his corner, they say, knock him out. Then he said, my left hand. Oh, okay, then, you know, box and be careful and outpoint him. And that maybe is that sense that there wasn't going to be a knockout as Verdejo hurt his left hand a couple rounds ago.
He's trying to knock him out with that overhand right still now. He's throwing a Clubber Lane type overhand right now.
Hit your worst enemy with this overhand right type punch.
A party has indeed broken out somewhere near ringside here in the theater at Madison Square Garden. If the danger in the ring is contact, the danger at ringside is contact high. And so far, we're fine.
A more mellow performance the last couple rounds.
I don't know, Jim. I'm starting to feel a little woozy here.
You have every right.
Oh, good shot.
And Verdejo took a good shot.
Yeah, he did.
What a competitive fighter Ivan Nahera is.
I would love to see him back, Jim, against a little bit lesser opponent, somebody that he could give a real problem to other than
Bring him back as anyone but Verdejo.
Yeah, exactly. Hopefully he'll take this, though, and learn. And the other thing is, you got to realize, this is the difference in having great boxing gyms around full of people. He's from San Antonio, which we don't know much about a lot of good fighters, but we do know some emerge from that area every now and then.
Now Verdejo switches southpaw for the first time in the fight. He has been known to fight entire rounds in the southpaw stance. Regards himself as being equally good from either side.
San Antonio, it's not Vegas or someplace like that, LA. Oh, good right hand.
By Nahera.
Yes.
Not New York.
That's because when Verdejo switched southpaw, he left himself open to a straight right hand.
Exactly.
Throws a heck of a right hook.
Oh, they are trading bombs here at the end. Rock 'em, sock 'em with the right hand.
And there's the Verdejo smile at the end of the 10th round of an entertaining but one-sided fight.
Highly entertaining.
And you mentioned that phrase, Max, which may in future years become a watchword, anyone but Verdejo.
When Lomachenko doesn't take credit for beating a young Verdejo in the Olympics, because no, he was just a baby, he's gonna be great. When Lomachenko says that about a fighter, you know that fighter's got the goods.
Well, Vasily Lomachenko is widely regarded a future opponent for Nicholas Walters, the fighter that you're about to see in the main event. But it's certainly not beyond the stretch of imagination that at some time in the not too terribly distant future, he could fight Verdejo as well.
Unless Verdejo outgrows the weight neighborhood.
Can you see Verdejo throughout the course of this fight, Jim, landing right hands high on the top of the head, left hooks right down the middle, all types of punches, not getting caught that much, right uppercuts up the middle, overhand rights right on the chin. I mean, the kid showed left uppercut up the middle. The kid showed a hell of an arsenal tonight. He showed every punch that we possibly could think of, and finally, it just got to Nahera, and down we've seen him go, and down we see him go again. That's what you call working taking your opponent apart, wearing him down, and then finishing strong.
You can see Verdejo is still gunning for the knockout at the end, Roy, as you surmised he would with those right hands. It left him open for some right hands, and they were just trading big right hands and reaching and hurting each other in the last 30 seconds of the fight.
I don't think he really hurt Verdejo, but I think Verdejo felt like he has an obligation to his fans to give them entertainment, so he shot for the knockout.
Now, speaking of an obligation to the fans, we'll show you Harold Letterman's unofficial scorecard before I throw it up to Michael Buffer, where we will hear the official scores. Harold has it 100-88. Now let's see what Michael Buffer has to say about what the official judges have seen in this fight. Let's go to Michael at ringside for the scores.
Ladies and gentlemen, here at the Theater of Madison Square Garden, we go to the scorecards. Matt Ruggiero and Don Trella both have it 100-88. Steve Weisfeld scores at 99-89. All three scores to the winner by unanimous decision. Still undefeated, still the WBO Latino lightweight champion, Felix Verdejo!
So Verdejo maintains his unbeaten record, and Nahera suffers his first loss. We'll take a look at the CompuBox numbers in the fight, which will show you the difference between what these two fighters were able to do in terms of offensive output. You see that Verdejo lands 93 punches more, throws 154 more, lands at a very high 40% connect percentage overall. Nahera didn't do too badly. It was an offensive fight. Jabs. Verdejo landing 26%, landing five times as many jabs as Nahera landed in the fight, limiting Nahera's jab percentage to the very low, 11%. Power punches, and there's the magic number. Told you over and over, fighter lands more than 50% of his power punches in the fight. He is very likely to win the fight. And 48 more landed power punches for Verdejo than was the case for Ivan Nahera in a very impressive victory, which will move Verdejo forward. His first 10-round fight, he remains unbeaten. So halfway through our doubleheader, we are in New York City for a big-time night at the Fights on Boxing After Dark. Still to come, hard-charging Nicholas Walters of Jamaica, who's been building a strong case for himself as one of boxing's must-see action stars. Two fights ago, he battered Victor Chenin before stopping him over five one-sided rounds to announce his arrival among the sport's upper echelon. And then last October, Walters ran over four-division champ Nonito Donaire en route to a sixth-round knockout in another statement-making performance. Standing in his way, undefeated Miguel Mariaga, who counts 18 knockouts among his 20 wins and is looking to put his name on the map with a big win here tonight in his first high-profile opportunity. But before we get to our main event, let's take a look at the upcoming HBO sports calendar. June 23, Real Sports returns featuring an examination of the shocking number of head injuries occurring in girls' soccer. June 26, boxing returns to True TV with undefeated 168-pounder Gilberto Ramirez taking on Derek Edwards. One night later, former two-division titleist Tim Bradley returns to the ring against undefeated up-and-comer Jesse Vargas. On July 11, HBO Latino offers up a 140-pound matchup between Mauricio Herrera and Hank Lundy. And July 25, don't miss the crusher in action as light heavyweight champ Sergey Kovalev puts his three title belts on the line against Najib Mohammadi. Also that night, Jean Pascal, KO'd by Kovalev in March in a thriller, faces off with Yuniaski Gonzalez. For all that and more, log on to InsideHBOBoxing.com. There's sadness in boxing this week in the wake of the passing of one of the sport's most illustrious referees, a man who helped to safeguard some spectacular thrills for fans of boxing here on HBO. Let's go to Michael Buffer in the ring.
Ladies and gentlemen, your attention, please. In the days leading up to tonight's event here at Madison Square Garden, some prominent members of the boxing fraternity have passed away. Boxing promoter Michael King,
two-time world middleweight champion Gene Fulmer, and a man who plied his trade with distinction for half a century. He was a prominent referee in this boxing ring and many others, referee Frank Cappuccino. At this time, ladies and gentlemen, please remain silent as we toll a final memorial count of 10 for Michael King, Gene Fulmer, and Frank Cappuccino. Rest in peace, you'll be missed.